Okay, thank you very much, Paul. Once again, thank you to organizers for the opportunity to speak on this topic. In the second lecture, I describe category SH frame needs of K and prove the main theorem of the second lecture, which stated that this category is equivalent to the category SH of K due to Morelli-Vygotsky. So then I made a remark that the category SH frame is of K is a triangulated category in a natural way. And I formulated lemma 3.2, which is a simple lemma that functors F and M bar big frame are usually inverse triangulated equivalences of triangulated categories SH frame needs of K and SH of K. So this category SH frame needs of K maybe looks a little bit artificial, and the main purpose of this lecture, of the first half of this lecture, is to show that it is not artificial at all. So it can be constructed. It is in fact coincide, as we will show, with the category of local objects for a localization functor. So, but before to do that, let me recall this formalism of localization functor. So given a triangulated category tau, we define a localization in tau as a triangulated endomorphism L. Maybe I will pronounce L tau to tau together with a natural transformation eta, such that eta evaluated on the morphism eta x coincide with the morphism eta of Lx for any x in tau. And eta induces an isomorphism Lx to A of L of x. We refer to A as a localization functor in tau. Such a localization functor determines a full subcategory K of L, whose objects are those X such that L of X vanishes. An object X is called L local. The morphism eta X from X to L of X is an isomorphism. We will write tau log for the full subcategory of L local objects. The functor L induces a functor L bar between tau modulo K of L to tau log. Let in be the full embedding, and let Q from tau to tau modulo K be the factorization functor. The full simple lemma is well known, and in fact can be proved pretty easily. Namely, the following is true. The functor L bar between tau modulo K of L and the functor which takes value in L log, and the functor Q composed with spin, which works like that. We first embed T log to log into Tor and then project to Q. Project via Q to Tor. Usually triangulated equivalences. Secondly, the functors L from Tor to Tor log and the inclusion, the full embedding from Tor log to Tor are left and right adjoint of each the other. So this is a general formalism. Simple formalism, and now we would like to apply the general formalism to our specific situation. For that, let's consider the functor M bar big frame between from SH of K to SH frame is of K. With the functor from the construction to 0.7. So it's in fact explicit formula is this. If you take an object E, then it takes its, one should first take its functorial co-fiber interpolation and SC, then apply the functor C star construction C star frame, and then apply stabilize in GM direction. But this is explicit formula for M bar big frame. So take this functor and set M big frame to be the composition. Firstly, projection from SH knees of K, the projection P to SH of K, and then apply the functor M bar big frame, which lands in SH frame knees of K. So we will get this functor, which we call M big frame, and the functors M big frame and M bar big frames are called big frame motive functors in these lectures.
Excuse me, Vanya, can you see the question in the Q&A?
No, means a sort of tangential question. Is the following analogous true for frame correspondences D at? Let me maybe try to answer on this question at the very end.
Okay, so we just keep the question
okay.
Paper. Thank you.
Yes, sorry. So definition. Let I be the full embedding and P be the canonical functor and set L frame motive to be this composition, the composition of three functors. So firstly we project from SH knees to SH of K, then we apply M bar big frame and we land in knees frame, and then we take the full embedding I. So we land in, so we start with this category. That explicit edge frame material of E is compared contour interpolation in Bayesian. So option L creative comes equipped with a Fanta transformation eater that takes a bispectrum E to a morphism in SH niche of K determined by this zigzag. So the left morphism is the cofiber replacement, and the right hand side morphism is taken from the construction 2.7, I think. So in the second, from the second lecture. So this second morphism is, I recall, is the Mativic equivalence, and the morphism beta E is level-wise local equivalence. This is the key proposition. The following assertions are true. First, the frame motif and eta is a localization in SH niche of K. Secondly, the kernel of L frame motif coincides with the kernel of P. And kernel of P, as we know, is generated by cones of embeddings or cones of projections of this form X cross A1. Plus 2 sigma of x, and we need to take cone of that and shifts of this cone. Then this is regarding the second point, and third is the most interesting point is that this full subcategory I of SH frame is of K is the full subcategory of L frame L frame Mativic local objects in SH niche of K. So the you'll say that kind of first time, or maybe the second time, I'm giving in the proof of lecture. So a sketch of the proof of the assertion one. Recall that F is just P precomposed with I. And also recall that the Fanta M bar big frame is quasi-inverse of the functor F by theorem 2.3. So consider the chain of functor isomorphisms. All isomorphisms in this chain are in fact equalities. And so we write down what is explicitly what is L frame Mativic. So it is this, then the second copy of L frame Mativic, this is this. We merge P and I, and we will get F by the very definition of F. And then this functor is isomorphic to the identity of SH of K. So therefore, we have this equality, the last equality is the very definition of the functor L frame mod. So we proved the first assertion. Prove now the second assertion. Take E, which is in the kernel of E, which is in kernel of P. then E is in the kernel of this composite functor. Of this composite functor. But this functor is L prime motivic, so therefore E is in care of L prime motivic. Take now E, prove another inclusion. Take now E, which is in care L prime motivic. So write down this explicitly. And then E in care of this, moreover, is in kernel of this composite functor. The first two, P precomposed with I, gives us the functor F. And the composition of F and M bar big frame coincide with the is isomorphic to the identity of SH of K. Therefore, we have this equality. And the last functor is the functor P, and therefore we have this equality. Therefore, we start with an object E, which was in kernel of frame motivic, and we prove that this E belongs to the kernel of P. So this proves the second assertion. I would like to say that the key, kind of the most difficult assertion, is the assertion three. So because it computes the category of L-frame motivic local objects as the category of I SH frame niece of K. Typically, it's very difficult to compute explicitly the category of local objects. So let's start with the proof. Of the functor L frame motivic, one has this inclusion because the last functor, so it is I composed with M bar big frame and composed with P, but here there is this I. Which implies this inclusion. So for each E by spectrum E, we claim that this category is contained in the full subcategory of L prime motivic local objects. Indeed, take an object E in this category and consider the error. Note that both object E and L frame motivic of E are in this full subcategory, SH frame niece of K, I of SH niece S of K. And recall that the arrow and recall that the arrow at the E becomes an isomorphism in SH of K. Sorry. This is due to the fact which I recalled you above, that this morphism is a motivic equivalent. This was formulated in the second lecture. So, taking back to the proof, Yes, and recall that this arrow becomes, so this arrow becomes an isomorphism is in SH of K. By theorem 2.3, the arrow eta E is an isomorphism already in I of SH frame Nis of K. Thus, E belongs to this category of local objects. So, on the other hand, if E is an object in SH Nis of K, which is L-frame motivic local, then this morphism is an isomorphism, but also is an isomorphism, but also L-frame motivic of E always belongs to this category. So above, we checked that we have this inclusion functor, and now we see that functor L prime motivic restricted to this subcategory lands in this category. Even if we do not restrict this functor just lands in this subcategory of SH Nis. So claim is that these two functors are quasi inverse of each the other, and this is very simple exercise. Just one should use the functor transformation eta for both compositions. So this proves the proposition. Now let me formulate the corollary. It is the formal corollary of the proposition and the lemma and the formal lemma 3.3. And corollary says that the following is true. The functor L bar frame motivic from this quotient category and the functor P precompose with the full embedding are usually inverse related categories, triangulated equivalences. And secondly, the functors L bar frame motivic and the functor full embedding functor in are left and right adjoint of each the other. So since SH Nis of K modular the quotient category SH Nis of K modular the kernel of P by the definition of P coincide with SH of K, this corollary and proposition 3.6 yield the following theorem, which is the main theorem of the first half of the lecture today. So the theorem tells us that the functors M bar big frame between SH of K to SH and the functor F from SH Nis frame K. So I'm usually inverse triangulated equivalences. In fact, this is nothing else as the exactly the statement of the theorem 2.3. But nevertheless, secondly, the functors M bar big frame and the full embedding functor I between the categories SH NIS of K and SH frame NIS of K are the left and the right adjoint of each the other. And I recall that I is the full embedding function. And eventually, the category I of SH frame NIS of K is the full subcategory of H frame mod local objects in SH NIS of K. So I would like to summarize the results of this part of this section as follows. We start with the local stable chromatopy category of shifts of S1 spectra, SH NIS S1. Which is also close symmetric monoidal triangulated. Then we stabilize SH NIS S1 of K with respect to the underfund smashing with GM smash 1. Doing this, we arrive at the triangulated category called SH NIS of K. Then we apply the explicit localization factor L frame motivic to SH NIS of K. We compute the quotient category or equivalently saying the full subcategory of corresponding local objects as the full subcategory I of SH frame NIS of K. And we prove that SH frame NIS of K is equivalent to the classical Morel-Vygotsky stable motivic chromatopy theory category SH of K. So let me maybe repeat once again that we introduced this functor, which is a localization functor from SH NIS of K to itself. Computed its local objects as this explicit full subcategory in SH NIS of K. So this means that this category SH frame NIS of K is not at all an artificially constructed category, but this is the category of L frame motivic local object. So also I would like to take a look at here, and I would like to stress that this functor and bar frame it is given by an explicit formula using like theta infinite sister frame of EC. So we take E to this. And this is the explicit A1 localization functor on this category. Very explicit. One localization function. Okay, so the first part of my talk is over, and I promised at the very first lecture that I will give some application, and so I'm passing to the second half of my lecture, which were H proofs of theorems 1.1, 1.2, and 1.3. But I will begin with the sketch of the theorem 1.3. And for that, I need to recall something, namely, there is so-called additivity here in this business, namely, it sounds like this. For any smooth schemes U and Y, we have canonical morphism of simplicial sets from here to there, to this part, to this product, just induced by projecting from y prime is joint union with y2 to y prime in frame node, and projecting from y prime is joint union y double prime to y double prime in frame node. And TM states that this morphism of simplicial sets is a weak equivalent of pointed simplicial sets. So this implies that so-called that the Siegel space of this form is special. Now, in fact, we could replace the scheme, the smooth scheme Y, by any smooth simplicial scheme. For instance, take a smooth scheme X. And consider a simplicial scheme, a simplicial object in frame node, which is X tensor S1. So remark, it is not, it is quite easy to check that phi node of C star frame U comma X tensor S1 is the zero, so is consists of one point. So it is, this simplicial set is connected for any X which is smooth. Thus, the Siegel space of this form is very special. And hence, is a bit special. It's very special. This Siegel space is very special. Hence, the Siegel S1 spectrum of this form is an omega S1 spectrum. But this S1 spectrum just tautologically coincides with this spectrum. So we take the suspension spectrum, the S1 suspension spectrum of the simplicial scheme X tensor S1. Then we applied the construction C star frame. We get again an S1 Mativicus S1 spectrum, and then we evaluate it on U. So, and the result, as I told, is this Siegel S1 spectrum. So the latter S1 spectrum is an omega S1 spectrum. Hence, there are two consequences. So firstly, the canonical morphism from the zero space of this spectrum to the infinite loop omega infinity S1 of T star frame of sigma inverse S1 of X tensor S1 is a weak equivalence for each U and X which are smooth over K. Particularly, particularly this equality holds. Namely, the Nisnevich-Ramatoki shifts of this motivic space coincide with the Nisnevich corresponding Nisnevich staple Ramatoki shift of this motivic S1 spectrum. So let us apply this. To prove theorem 1.3. I recall that theorem 1.3 states that for any X and for any field extension K capital over K, here K is infinite and perfect. The RC homotopy, okay, the ordinary homotopy group of the simplicial set frame delta dot k capital comma x tensors 1 coincides with the weight evaluated on k with the A1 homotopy shift of the pi suspension of x plus smash S1 evaluated on K. On the left hand side, we have a group, and on the right hand side, globe. This is the statement of theorem 1.3, which we supposed to prove. First, recall that. This canonical morphism of bispectra is a motivic equivalence. This was formulated in examples. In the second lecture, in example one. So this is the motivic equivalence. And from other side, this spectrum is in SH frame Nis of K. So this tells that firstly, let me be a little bit slow. Let's denote by E this spectrum, by spectrum. Take its A1 with zero homotopy group, homotopy shift. As was stated in the second lecture, for each bispectrum E from this category, its weight zero A1 homotopy shift coincides with the Nisnevich shift of the zero weights of the spectrum E. But since my spectrum E is of this form, its weight zero spectrum E of not it in a very easy way. one should take just this suspension, motivic suspension spectrum, S1 suspension spectrum of Xn 0 is 1, and apply the construction C star frame. This will be exactly the way 0 by trivial reason, by the definition of C star frame construction of the by spectrum E. So, okay, therefore, as I explained, there is this equality. So A1 Ramatopi shifts of weight zero are computed as Nisnevich Ramatopi stable Ramatopi shift of this spectra E of zero. But from other side, we have proved that this Nisnevich shift coincide with on the previous page, we have proved there was this formula in rectangle that this Nisnevich shift coincide with the stable homotopy Nisnevich shift coincide with the ordinary Nisnevich shift of this motivic space. Particularly for any field K capital, which is an extension of the field K. In this theorem, K is also infinite and perfect. This I already mentioned. One has this equalities. So this homotopy group of this space coincide with this stable homotopy group of this S1 spectrum, but on the other hand, this homotopy group coincides by due to this equality coincide with this one evaluated theory on K. Evaluated on K. Yes, this is the end of the proof of theorem 1.3. Now let me prove theorem 1.2. By theorem 1.3, we have this equality with finite coefficients as well, because we have with integral coefficients, and therefore we have as a consequence with finite coefficients as well. And somewhere I missed the complex numbers, right? And also there is a deep theorem due to Mark Levine saying that the A1 homotopy shift of weight zero with finite of the bisuspension spectrum of the bisuspension spectrum of this form with finite coefficients and evaluated on point, so evaluated on the complex number C, coincide with the ordinary stable homotopy group of the space X plus suspended one times with finite coefficients Z mod N. This is exactly the statement of theorem 1.2. Now, let us go to theorem 1.1. And again, due to theorem 1.3, we have this equality. This time without finite coefficient. This equality holds with without finite coefficient. But this time X is point, And this is again Marx Levin theorem, which says that there is this equality. That on the right-hand side, we have the R's stable homotopy group, of S12. So remark, one can show that in fact, there is a weak equivalence between of two spaces. From one hand side, simplicial set frame delta dot C comma S1, and from other side, the omega infinity, sigma infinity in the usual sense of S1 top. Let me do not discuss this today. The last I would like to discuss is the Siegel theorem, Mativic version of the Siegel theorem. Sorry. Proof of Siegel theorem, Mativic version. I'm not so I will prove it in the same formulation as I have written in the first lecture, as I formulated in the first lecture. There is more general statement, yeah, but let me skip that. So I will give the proof. And therefore, yeah, so I will start with the end of the proof. This is the Mativic space on the right hand side. Sister frame of X tensor S1. And on the left hand side, omega infinity sigma infinity omega S1 infinity omega GM infinity of sigma GM infinity sigma S1 infinity of X plus smash S1. And this zigzag, is the zigzag of local equivalences. This is how one can read the statement of the Mativic version of the Siegel theorem. So let me start the proof. So the Mativic S1 spectra, this one, and this one are both local wise omega S1 spectra. Why? So firstly, let's take a look on the left-hand side. On the left-hand side, we applied the Mativic de-looping function, and therefore, the left-hand side is automatically local-wise omega S1 spectra. It is even section-wise omega S1 spectra. And let's take a look on the right-hand side. The right-hand side is in fact wasn't on the page page one. It is in fact section-wise omega S1 spectra as well. Let us go over to the page one. And I will show you. Yes, this is the formula this is a weak equivalence of simplicial space for each huge x in smooth of k. So even section wise, but it, yeah, local wise, moreover, omega S1 spectra. Since the spectrum E, which is this one, is in SH frame nis of K, the arrow from its weight 0 S1 spectrum to the omega infinite GM loops of E is a stable local equivalence. This is the property, one of the key properties of the of spectra from this category, that its omega infinity GM loops functor is computed by taking E of naught. So this is a stable local equivalence. From other sides, so this morphism is a stable local equivalence of material spectrum. But from other side, both the spectra are local wise omega S1 spectra. Thus, this morphism of material spaces is a local equivalence, weak equivalence of material spaces. Now consider the arrow from this material space to as consider this arrow. As I have shown you appealing to the page one, this arrow is a scheme wise weak equivalence. Thus the composite arrow is a local weak equivalence of material spaces. What eventually we have, so this is a local weak equivalence of material spaces. Eventually one has, so we have this morphism, which is local equivalence of material spaces. Then we have this equality. This is equality. This is just notation. We use ring notation for E. E was taken to be this spectrum. I'm very close to the end. Yes, so once again, this arrow is a local equivalence of material spaces, as we already have checked. This is the equality, just the equality. And there is this arrow, which is scheme-wise, I claim that it is scheme-wise weak equivalences of material spaces. So on the right hand and on the left hand side, we have this the composition of the two functors of formula groups functors. But inside we have inside we have bisuspension spectrum of X plus meshes one, and we have we applied T staff reconstruction to this T staff reconstruction to this bias spectrum. And as I mentioned above, this URU inside is a motivic equivalence. Therefore, it is an isomorphism in SH, and therefore, applying this functor, we get firstly an isomorphism of motivic S1 spectra, and from another side, since this functors are omega loops functor, we will get scheme wise weak equivalence of motivic spaces. So so this arrow is a scheme wise weak equivalence of motivic spaces, and this arrow is a local equivalence of motivic spaces. This is the Segal theorem. So we proved the motivic version of the Segal theorem, not only in its full generality, but in very much reasonable generality. So thank you very much. This is the end of my third lecture. This is the end of my small. I am very grateful to organize and to participants for giving me opportunity to perform this this series of lectures. Thank you.
Well, thank you very much, Vanya, from all of us for a very nice lecture series. So we can start the questions. Maybe I can ask the first question for you.
Yes.
So so the theory of framed correspondences is now in a it's a subject that's now in a great shape. Much
yes.
Thanks to many papers that you've been written. But I would like to ask you how you see the how the subject will develop in the next years.
How the subject
will keep developing over the next years.
So I think that there are quite a lot of questions trying to attack by using this technique. So and also we all know that many people, including very young people, use this technique, and part of them use the infinite category technique to develop this frame business from slightly different viewpoint. Maybe I would like to mention just one conjecture, which is kind of a favorite of mine. One could replace frame correspondences, which we could call right now, by rational frame, by regular frame correspondences, because we have we use just regular functions, by rational frame correspondences. Rational frame correspondences are defined in the very second page of the Voevodsky notes of frame on frame correspondences. I made a little so right conjecture. So They look like that frame rational of and of instead of using regular functions, we can use rational functions as I told. So then we have this nice arrow, each regular function. And therefore you have this arrow. And it is stated, yeah, sister frame. So it is formulated in the second Vygotsky notes on frame correspondences, which are now available on his web page, that this space is always looping omega p1 infinity sigma infinity p1 of x plus. I like very much this conjecture, and I think it would be wonderful to prove such a conjecture because this okay. So you need this space is perfect Mativi delooping of X plus. This is one conjecture I would like to see to be proven in the future, but also you could see that several times I appealed to the beautiful theorem and deep theorem due to Mark Levine, and I would be very much happy, and some other people would be very much happy to prove to avoid Mark Levine result. Namely, for that, there is the only one ingredient, which is a topological one, which is absent. Namely, one needs to show that cancellation theorem holds after topological, after complex realization of the spectrum of the form frame, say, sister frame of sigma of X plus. Yes, and then apply complex point to that. As was explained more or less, and as people know, from the, as was explained in Sasha Nishitov's talk, and that the left-hand side means this functor can be replaced by simplicial, all the terms of the bispectra can be replaced by simplicial schemes. Take complex points of that, and one should expect, and from Mark Levine's theorems, there is, there is a reasoning for that, that there is a cancellation theorem in topology, topological one, for taking, after taking complex points, that the previous column, the previous S1 spectra is the ordinary S1 loops of the next one. This is a theorem which sounds like, how is it called, Dalton theorem for frame, in topological frame context, or Dalton theorem for complex Gabordian conflicts. This would be wonderful to prove. To my mind, this is first very much expected, and secondly, it is have nice application. And maybe the last what I would like to say that CDH context. So this frame business should be developed, I think, to CDH context, maybe widely. Okay, for the second right now, maybe I will stop on expected questions. There are more questions. Maybe I will fix them over the summer and put on the web, I don't know, like that.
Okay, thanks a lot, Vanya, for sharing all your insight on this subject. Are there any other questions? Doesn't seem to be the case. So then, let me thank you again for a wonderful lecture series. So thanks a lot.
Thank you very much. Thank you very much, Paul. It's, I would say, not very easy to be a lecturer, but as I noticed, it's more, I think, more difficult or more tough to be an organizer. So, yeah, sure, absolutely. So, I have seen this on samples of other people organizing something like this, yes, and they told me about the experiences. So coffee is very essential. I'm absolutely sure, otherwise the mind is in foggy.
Okay, before you go, Vanya, maybe there's a question.
Okay.
Do you have time for a question, Vanya, or does Ura is asking if the notes you used are available somewhere?
Sure. I could send this note. If there is IGS source, this conference source, where could I send my file? Then I will do that.
Okay.
So I am ready to do that. So am I right that there is an IGS source where
I could put
my file?
On the YouTube of your channel of your video, we can put your file in the description. So you should send the file to me, and then I'll transmit to the HS.
Okay. I will send the file to you. Sure. Thank you very much.
It's Elizabeth.
Okay.
And just to tell you that generally the notes are online with the video at the same time. So if you send them just now, it will be online tomorrow, the latest, I think. Maybe.
Okay, I will send a little bit later, but today.
Okay.
A little bit later. Thank you very much. Yeah, wonderful.